Perfect. So with that, I'll go through the policy reading as usual. By the way, welcome everybody to this meeting. The Linux Foundation Antitrust Policy. Linux Foundation meetings involve participation by industry competitors, and it is the intention of the Linux Foundation to conduct all of its activities in accordance with applicable antitrust and competition laws. It is therefore extremely important that attendees adhere to meeting agendas and be aware of and not participate in any activities that are prohibited under applicable US state, federal, or foreign antitrust and competition laws. Examples of types of action that are prohibited at Linux Foundation meetings and in connection with Linux activities are described in Linux Foundation antitrust policy. If you have questions about these matters, please contact your company counsel, or if you're a member of the Linux Foundation, feel free to contact Andrew Updegrove of the firm Gaston Updegrove LLP, which provides legal counsel to the Linux Foundation. Hyperledger is committed to creating a safe and welcoming community for all. For more information, please visit our Hyperledger Code of Conduct. So, welcome everybody. We're going to have a good speech today by Tom Corbett of Digital Assets. I'll leave the stage directly to him to have the presentation. Tom, please take the word. The stage is yours. And feel free to show the slide, the deck.
Thanks, Andrea. Can everybody hear me and see the slides okay?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Okay, very good.
Yes.
So first of all, good morning, good afternoon, good evening from wherever you are in the world. Thanks to Andrea and to Hyperledger Trade Finance Special Interest Group for kindly inviting Digital Asset to present this webinar. And thanks to everyone else as well for attending and making the time to participate in the webinar. So today we're going to introduce you to Digital Asset, our Daml application platform, and how Daml is transforming supply chain and trade finance for global enterprise. My name is Tom Corbett. I'm based here in Dublin, very stormy Dublin today with Storm Barra in the middle of it at the moment. I'm originally from London, as you can probably tell from my accent. I'm still working on my Irish accent. I think I still have a bit of a way to go. I'm sales associate for the EMEA industries team here in Digital Asset. So I look after new clients in the supply chain, trade, finance, manufacturing, retail, luxury goods and telco industries. And alongside me is my colleague, Ian Woodgate. So I'll let him just introduce himself quickly.
So thank you very much, Tom, and good afternoon, everyone. It's great to be here today. My name's Ian. I am a technical sales engineer with Digital Asset, and I shall be walking through the demo today.
Thanks, Ian. So today, I think what makes sense is probably just start from the beginning. So before we dive into kind of the trade finance side of things and the demo, we'll speak a little bit, give you a bit of an introduction into Digital Asset and Daml. I'm not sure how familiar the audience is with Digital Asset. We're a global organization that are headquartered in New York. We have six offices globally. We're backed by some of the largest financial institutions and global technology corporations. You can see some of them on the right-hand side there. As creators of the Linux Hyperledger Foundation, Digital Asset acquired Hyperledger in 2015 and then donated the brand whilst helping to create the foundation. Digital Asset provides extensive industry knowledge and experience in helping clients build real-world solutions with smart contracts and blockchain technology. The 4th of April is Daml Day, which recognizes the date with which we open sourced our Daml smart contract language. We were founded in 2014 and we grew out of the financial services industry. You may be asking why I'm showing a financial services slide on a trade finance webinar. But because basically the reason that we're growing so quickly is because we're creating a step change in the financial services industry improving processes across the end-to-end lifecycle of nearly all the functions within finance. Some of our clients would include the Australian Securities Exchange, Goldman Sachs, and NASDAQ, to name a few. But this step change from digital asset is also enabling other industries, such as supply chain, manufacturing, trade finance, and healthcare, because the process efficiency, automation and security characteristics of Daml are as applicable, if not more applicable, to those industries as they are within financial services. So digital asset are the creators of the Daml application platform, which is quickly becoming the industry standard for enterprise business and multi-party systems of record. So leading enterprise businesses rely on Daml to transform their disparate data silos into synchronized networks that eradicate latency and errors and guarantee consistent, shared, and secure data. So we solve the age-old problem of keeping non-trusted parties in sync with their data and completely eliminating reconciliation pains. So currently, workflows stretch across multiple participants. You have multiple technologies, different systems, different infrastructures. There's no common data model. There's no common data governance model. And what this results in is significant reconciliation and conflict management, all of which is costly to maintain. So if you try to solve these challenges with traditional or legacy technology, you end up with those reconciliation and conflict management challenges. So what Daml does is standardize the data model, standardize the data governance model with a virtual shared state system. So that means that we eliminate the reconciliation processing pains and provide the privacy and security characteristics that are required for enterprise systems of record, whilst also enabling extensible Daml networks. Traditionally, when you want to solve for these distributed workflow challenges, you will typically examine some of the infrastructure providers. And these will be long projects that will involve lots of evaluations and trade-offs between the ledger designs or, you know, committing to development on a native language, which can, you know, create risk for your project, for the project that you're undertaking. Daml removes the risk by abstracting the application layer from the infrastructure layer and allows you to build applications with all of the distributed computing benefits, but connect to any ledger of choice during the lifetime of the application. The time and the cost for building these solutions for these pains with traditional technology can often be a barrier to entry. With Daml, we focus on the business logic, which enables you to build your applications and move to production more quickly and deliver value from your applications from day one. And all of the solutions that are built with Daml are future-proofed, as they are portable across storage layers and interoperable across networks. And this is a key differentiator for Daml, as there are maybe not any truly agnostic and interoperable smart contract languages currently in production. So I'm sure we're all familiar with smart contracts. So just a quick introduction for those that aren't. Smart contracts are small computer programs that are executed consistently by each node within a distributed network. Daml is a unique smart contract language in that it starts from the building blocks of rights and obligations. Any asset class, such as a letter of credit, can be accurately tokenized as a bundle of rights and obligations. And the rights and obligations can also be used to model shared workflows to fully automate complex multi-party processes across an ecosystem of parties, such as a trade finance ecosystem. So when you build your applications with Daml, you can connect them with all of the benefits of a distributed ledger or with the existing tech stacks and run them centrally. Daml connects to all of the leading enterprise blockchains and DLTs and databases. So you're future-proofing your tech stack by choosing Daml. And Daml's design makes it low code, which enables your developers to create applications and innovate very quickly and efficiently, making it faster to get your products and services to market. And we're creating with Daml a very low barrier to entry to start innovating around your existing tech stack and start modernizing legacy tech and or building new future-proofed products. So now that we've kind of given you a bit of an intro and a bit of an insight to digital asset and Daml, we kind of want to take a look towards trade finance and how Daml can be used in this area, right? So if we start to look at some of the, I suppose, the current challenges that we have within trade finance, the global trade finance ecosystem is estimated to be worth $5.2 trillion. And according to McKinsey, there's a gap in trade finance availability that's estimated at $1.7 trillion. So if we look at some of the macro economic factors that are affected, some of the macroeconomic challenges that we're seeing within trade finance at the moment, over the last little while, we've all seen the increase in the global supply chain uncertainty and how this has maybe had an impact on banks' appetite for risk. Small and medium enterprises make up the majority of firms within global economies. And again, according to McKinsey, 40% of these SMEs had their trade finances rejected last year. So you can see that there's some, you know, some current macroeconomic factors affecting the ecosystem. When you couple this with the more, I suppose, legacy and operational side of the trade finance ecosystem, it's a complex web of technology, complex web of systems, different data models, lots of different participants, multiple parties within that ecosystem. It relies on a manual paper-based process, which can be time-consuming, and especially when you have complex transactions that involve multiple parties, this means that the actual transactions themselves can be prone to delays. And all this does is create more bureaucracy and regulation and creates barriers for these SMEs to get access to structured trade finance and increases the cost for them to do so. So if we look at a future state solution with Daml to solve for the challenges that we looked at on the last slide. So Daml, a future state solution, would leverage the unique properties of Daml to provide all of the relevant participants with a streamlined process for structured trade finance. Daml will provide a single source of truth for capturing and standardizing data across all of the legal entities and participants within the trade finance ecosystem, with an automated rules-based workflow that eliminates the current manual processes and facilitates a seamless flow of information across the ecosystem. But importantly with that, you have the strict privacy and security characteristics with the ability to set entitlements for key participants, such as manufacturers, suppliers, banks, insurers, and so on. So this is what you know, potentially what the future could look like through using the Daml solution. So we're going to look at what one small part of that now for a demo overview. Before we jump into to the demo itself and Ian takes you through the demo, I'm just going to kind of outline exactly what we're doing here. So I will draw your attention to the right hand side of the screen. So where it said we've created a trade finance loan approval process using Daml. And that will include like different points within that process. So we'll have participant and supply chain onboarding. We'll go through the certification of the participants within the supply chain. The manufacturer will create a fulfillment request that then cascades down through the different suppliers that are in the supply chain. One of those tier three suppliers will then request trade finance, and we'll see how that trade finance loan can be approved by the bank in the application. A couple of things to call out. This is a very simplified process, and we've simplified it for demo purposes, but you can make it as arbitrarily complex as required with your with your specific use case. And it's also open source, right? So Daml is the Daml structured trade finance demo is open source, is available on GitHub, and we'll make the details of that available after the webinar. So one last slide from me. I'll just run you through the flow of the trade finance demo. On the left-hand side, you have the participants. So you have the manufacturer. You have, in our case, we're going to have three suppliers. You've got the external auditor, and you've got the bank. So step one will be the manufacturer onboarding their supply chain. So they'll onboard all of the different suppliers onto the supply chain. What's key here and what we'll see through this flow is the dotted lines represent visibility into the smart contracts for the different participants. It's all done on a permission basis. So when the manufacturer is onboarding the supply chain, all of the other participants can see who else is on that supply chain. So once they've been onboarded, the manufacturer will request certification from an external auditor. So this could be for any type of certification. For example, it could be to validate the supply chain participants. It could be for CSR requirements or green credentials. And the auditor has visibility into who the participants are within the supply chain. So the auditor goes away, does their due diligence for the happy path scenario, and we will say that the auditor has certified the supply chain. The next step then is the manufacturer to create an order fulfillment request for their tier one supplier. So that goes through to the tier one supplier. They can they accept the order fulfillment request, and then that cascades down where they subcontract part of that order to the tier two supplier, and the tier two can accept that and subcontract to a tier three supplier. So by the time we get to the tier three supplier, in this case, it's going to be Gamma Copper, they will have visibility into an audit trail of those contracts. So they won't necessarily see the specific details that are of the contract between the manufacturer and the tier one supplier, but they will see that they will have an audit trail that a contract exists, and that data will give them confidence that when they go to the bank to request a loan, that they will be able to prove the cash flow and the contract, which will help them to, first of all, get loan approval and also potentially get more favorable terms from the bank. And you can see here that the bank will also get visibility into that contract audit trail to enable them to feel confident that they can approve that loan. So again, for the happy path, we will go into, we will let the bank approve the loan for the supplier, for the tier three supplier. And that will be the flow of the trade finance demo. Before I hand over to Ian, just the last bit from me is just to kind of validate for you, you know, what's the point of this? Why does it make sense for these participants to be part to be part of this demo? So for the manufacturer, it means they can validate the work, and it means that they can deliver on their CSR initiatives with a real-time audit trail. For the suppliers, it means that they can validate the tier two, tier three suppliers of the work done, but it gives them better access to trade finance in improved terms, the provable linkage to that top level procurement. The external auditor gets a more efficient certification process using smart contracts, and the bank themselves enables them to increase the addressable market for trade finance solutions with a verifiable proof of contract and cash flows from creditworthy borrowers. So that's it from me for now. I'm sure you're sick of the sound of my voice, so I'm going to hand you over to Ian, who's going to take us through the demo.
Thank you very much, Tom. So I want to start actually by looking at some code. It's always good to kind of look under the bonnet. So this is the code. Hopefully you can see my screen now. Is that showing okay?
Yes, sir, all good.
Yeah.
Good. So this is the code that you're actually about to see running, okay? This is how we define our smart contracts, and it's all written in the language Daml that Tom talked about just now. I'm not going to go into it in any detail. Don't worry, this is not like a code review session, but a couple of things I do just want to highlight. The first is that the entire application is about 240 odd lines of code. We then got some initialization scripts after that. Okay, so it's quite short. And that's really representative of the fact that DAML is very efficient at encapsulating our data models, our data governance, and our business logic. The other thing that I wanted to highlight as well is that there's no implementation specific code here. This is pure business logic. And this is one of the key strengths of DAML, actually, is that you can take this code and you can run it as is on any of our supported ledgers in a decentralized way without any modifications, okay? And participants can run their own nodes in that, and they could share nodes. And the DAML toolset ensures that we have consistency, sharding, and security of data across all of those nodes. What I will do is I'll just go and look at one example of what we call a template here. And the template really is a blueprint for our smart contracts, okay? So you can see here, it's got quite a simple structure. We define the template itself. We define some data. So this is like our data model for the onboarding invitation. We've got a list of contractors and a new subcontractor that we're onboarding. We then define who's able to sign the contract. Who's basically able to create one of these contracts or to archive it. And then we've got a couple of what we call choices. They're really like methods, if you're familiar with OO type programming. We've got the ability to accept an invitation. And what you can see here, all this is doing is if you accept the invitation, it creates a new contractual relationship, adding the new contractor to the list of subcontractors. And if you reject, it does nothing other than return, okay? So that's the kind of language that we use to build out our templates and on our smart contract-based solution. If you want to know more about that and have a go yourself, as Tom's already alluded, this code here and this whole demo is open source. You can download that from GitHub, and we'll be sharing the link. And you can also download our SDK for free from www.daml.com. Okay, so now onto the demo. And just to give a quick overview of what we're going to see again, we're going to create a simplified supply chain. We're going to have the top level manufacturer of the supply chain going to request supplier certification from an external auditing body. We're then going to create some orders and have those cascade down the chain of suppliers. And then we're going to have a subcontractor ask for trade finance from a bank. And they're going to present that audit trail of the order hierarchy as evidence of their creditworthiness. And that includes the signature from the top level manufacturer in the chain. As Tom has already said, the demo is simplified. It can, of course, be arbitrarily complex. The focus is really on the process. I'm just using a simple developer UI for demo purposes, and also because it actually helps show you what's happening under the bonnet. But for a production ready app, you would, of course, build a richer UI than what I'm going to show you today. And the scenario that we're going to use is that of the manufacturer of phones, okay, mobile phones. So what I've got is I've got a phone manufacturer, which is imaginatively called Ultraphones. Ultraphones is going to order phones from a company called PhoneMaker. PhoneMaker is going to order cases from Alpha Cases. Alpha Cases is going to order switches from Beta Switches, and Beta Switches is going to order copper from Gamma Copper, okay? And there's a couple of other parties or roles that I'll bring into this as well. We're going to bring in an external auditor who's going to perform the certification of the supply chain, and also a bank that's going to issue the trade finance. Okay. So what I've got here is I've got two windows, and I'm going to use those for the different profiles that we're going to log in as to complete the demo, okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to log into this demo application. It's using the smart contracts that we just saw at the back end, and therefore it can run as a decentralized application. For today, just to explain how I'm running it, I'm running this on a sandbox ledger, which is running locally on my laptop, but I could take exactly the same code as it is and run it on any supported DLT without making any changes. Okay, so the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to log in as my phone manufacturer in the top window, which is Ultraphones. Okay, and just to explain the UI that we can see here, I've got some menus down the right left-hand side, a couple that I'll draw your particular attention to. I've got templates. This shows me all of the smart contract templates that I've got available from which I'm able to create, create smart contracts, and we'll see those in use as we go through the demo. I've got contracts. These are the actual instances of my contracts that are in existence and that I've got permission to see and interact with. And we've also got filtered views down here. For example, these are empty at the moment, but they will, as we progress, you will see them filling, and they're just filtered views basically off the smart contracts. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to create our supply chain by onboarding our subcontractors. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use this first smart contract, which is basically representative of me as Ultraphones, and I'm going to create an onboarding invitation. Okay, and just one argument for this, I'm going to onboard my supplier, which is PhoneMaker. So what I'm actually doing here is I'm calling one of those choices, one of those methods on the smart contract instance that we on the smart contract instance that we saw the template of earlier. Okay, so that's going to call that choice. And what that's done is behind the scenes that has gone and created this onboarding invitation. Okay, if I look at that, we can see it's got some information there about who the signatories are, who's able to observe or see it, and who the contractors are so far. Obviously, just myself, Ultraphones, and I've trying to subcontract PhoneMaker. Okay, so what I'm going to do now in the bottom half of the screen is I will sign in as PhoneMaker. And you can see that PhoneMaker, when I look at my contracts, I can see both the contract role, that's me, but also the onboarding invitation that was created just a few seconds ago. So PhoneMaker, let's say they're happy, they're going to choose to accept that invitation. And if, as I do this, if you watch the top screen, what you'll see is that our onboarding invitation is archived, and we create a new smart contract, which is a contractual relationship. And this, you can see, has been signed by both parties. And it specifies that we've currently got two contractors in the chain. Okay. So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to leave that one so we can see the contractual relationship here. Let's say that PhoneMaker now wants to use the contractual relationship, and they are going to onboard a subcontractor, and they're going to onboard alpha cases. Okay. This performs a similar process to what we've seen previously. I'll sign in now as alpha cases. You can see I've got the invitation. I'm going to choose to accept that invitation. And again, if you watch the top window when I accept, we'll see that the contractual relationship has now expanded, and alpha cases is also now a member of that relationship. Okay, so the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to repeat the process to build up the rest of my supply chain. Okay, so alpha cases is going to onboard beta switches. Sign in as beta switches. Accept the invitation. Again, watch the top window when I accept it. There we go. And then beta switches is going to use that contractual relationship to onboard the last subcontractor, which is Gamma Copper. I can see there's some questions coming up. It's probably going to be easiest if we cover them up at the end, but please do feel free to post any questions into the chat as we progress. So we're going to onboard Gamma Copper.
What's veloce? Ah, veloce.
Hey, Andrew, unmute yourself, please.
And then I'll log in as Gamma Copper. See the invitation, and accept that invitation. And so now I've built up my full supply chain, okay? So now that's complete. Let's say that our top level manufacturer, Ultraphones, They decide that they want to certify their supply chain, okay? So that could be to meet some ESG requirements. They want to go and get verification from a third-party organization like Greenpeace or Fairtrade or the Rainforest Alliance or Living Wage or something like that, okay? So what they can do is they can go ahead now and they can use the contractual relationship. They can say that they want to request certification. And they're prompted to who they want to go and do that certification exercise. So let's say it's our external auditor.
And Ian, just while you're doing that, just to kind of highlight here that if you have a supply chain background, then you may know that setting up these supply chains can often be quite slow and complex. So this demo is kind of illustrating how you can do that digitally with smart contracts. It's also then an incentive here, as we've seen the onboarding of suppliers, there's an incentive for them to onboard as it then makes it easier for them to get access to that trade finance. So they're more likely to want to become part of this workflow.
Absolutely. Thanks, Tom. So we're going to request certification from our external auditor. So I'll go ahead and do that. Then in the bottom window, we'll sign in as the external auditor. And a couple of things to draw your attention to on this. You'll see that I see a different set of menu options as the external auditor. And I also see a different set of contracts, say, compared to some of the other participants like the Ultraphones. And that's because Daml applies permissions so that people only get to see the smart contracts that they have permission to see, okay? In fact, if they're on running on their own node, they only even receive that sharded data if they've got permission to receive it. So you can see that as the external auditor, I've been sent a certification request. I can look into it. I can see all the data that's associated with that, including the list of organizations that I need to certify. I can go off now and do my offline processes to make sure that these companies are meeting the required standards. And when I'm satisfied that that's the case, I can choose to certify the chain. Okay, so again, you can see in the top now, that's archived the certification request contract and created a certification approval. So as the supplier now, as a manufacturer now, I beg your pardon, I can go in there and I can see all of the organizations that have been certified. And obviously, and I can see that that's been signed by the external auditor. Okay, so I'm happy now that I've got a compliant supply chain and that they've been certified and I've got the evidence of that.
And again, it's a digital representation of that process, so it's done a lot faster and a lot quicker than maybe a traditional or legacy paper-based manual process of certification.
Absolutely. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to start placing orders, okay? So we're going to start requesting fulfillment. To do that, I'm going to just grab this contract ID because I'm going to associate the orders with this particular contractual relationship that the suppliers have. So just go ahead and grab that. Obviously, in a real UI, you would have a more sophisticated method of doing that, but it shows you what's happening under the scenes. So let's go ahead now, and we're going to go and request fulfillment. So as Ultraphones at the top level, I'm going to create a fulfillment request. Okay. And I'm going to request that from my phone maker. And let's say it's phones one, there's an ID, product ID, it could be the same. Let's say I'm going to order 50,000 phones at a unit price of say $500. Obviously this is simplified here, you can collect whatever data you'd need to in reality. And I'm going to associate that with the contractual relationship that we've defined earlier. Okay, so that'll go ahead now, we'll submit that. And what you can see on the contracts now is we've now created this new fulfillment request. So what I'm going to do now in the bottom screen is we'll log in as our phone maker. I can see that fulfillment request. And I'm going to choose to accept that. And you can see that's now resulted in an order. So an important thing to note here is we're going to create the orders now and cascade them down the supply chain. the system is built such that the permissioning and the security means that only the parties at either side of an order see the order. It's not visible to the whole supply chain. So whilst everyone gets to see the supply chain, they're not able to see the individual orders. Those are kept confidential between the two counterparties to each order. Okay, so PhoneMaker has now got that order. What they are now going to do is they're going to cascade that order down the supply chain. So looking at the order here, so I nudged the mouse, so it's 4,996, not 50,000 anymore, but that's fine. They're going to subcontract that order. And so let's say they're going to subtract that to alpha cases. Case one, it's 50,000 again, let's say. Maybe the cases are $100. And this pattern actually of seeing this kind of, this repeating pattern that you're seeing of making a proposal and then having it accepted is a common pattern that you see a lot of within Daml. Basically, Daml enforces the fact that you can't put somebody into an obligated position without their agreement. So this forces us to obtain consent from somebody before they're put in that obligated position. So we're going to accept that. Okay. And now we'll log out as PhoneMaker. We'll log in as Alpha Cases. We can see that I've got a fulfillment request here. I'm going to accept that. And now we're going to see that we've got an order. Again, this order now you can see is just between me, PhoneMaker, and Alpha Cases and PhoneMaker. It's not visible to everybody else. I can see the contractors in the supply chain, but they cannot see this actual contract. We're going to subcontract that as Alpha Cases. We're going to subcontract that to beta switches. So we're going to get 50,000 switches, maybe at $50 each. Submit that. And then lastly, as I'm going to go in and log in as beta switches, accept that request. Take that order. I'm now going to subcontract that again to gamma copper. You might measure copper in, but let's say there's 20,000 of those. Price, say, $20. We'll submit that. And then lastly, we'll sign in as gamma copper, do the last accept. And now we've completed the whole cascading of the order. So if I go and look at this order from the bottom level, beta switches, so they can see this order is between beta switches and gamma copper. You can see all the details of the order. And we can see who the contractors are in the supply chain. Although just to reemphasize again, those contractors are not able to see the details of this order. This is confidential between myself and myself as gamma copper and beta switches. Okay, so that's good. Now let's say that in order to fulfill this order, gamma copper wants to make a trade finance request. Okay, what they can do now is off the back of this order and the fact that it's got embedded within it the whole supply chain, they can request a loan. So let's say they're going to request a loan from the bank, maybe $100,000. So go ahead now and submit that. Okay, so now that's done, we can now sign in as the bank. And again, you can see similar to the external auditor, the bank sees a different view. They see different contracts as visible. They can see the loan request here. So it's from Gamma Copper. If they can see who the contractors are in the supply chain, You can see the amount and the who's requested it and the currency. So they can review that, and then they can go through and do their due diligence, what are the processes they want to do. But because they can see this supply chain and they can have confidence that Ultraphones is a reputable business, they're more inclined to grant finance at favorable terms. Okay. So they're going to go ahead and approve the loan. And that could be an improvement in principle and then could hand off to the bank's payments existing systems at this point, or it could even integrate via our Daml API to automate the payments. So it could even integrate with the bank system so that you achieve a straight through payment. But let's say they're happy with that, so they'll go ahead and approve the loan. So the full amount. And then so finally, if I log back in now as my Gamma Copper, I can see that I have now got my loan approved. And I can see the details of that, and it's obviously from the bank. So I've obtained the trade finance that I want to obtain. So that concludes the demo, and I'll now hand back to Tom.
Thanks, Ian. So do you just want to stop sharing your screen and I can...
Yep.
So thanks again, Ian, for doing that. So this is, I suppose, the last slide that we have just before we move to any questions that anyone has. But basically, it's just outlining kind of what are the benefits for structured trade finance using Daml. So it makes it easier to create supply chains by onboarding participants with straight through, easy to use, transparent workflows. You get real-time notification and visibility of participants into parts or the entire workflow based on their eligibility. Sub-transaction level privacy, so the participants can only view contract details that they are entitled to see. Improved efficiency through processing trade finance requests for banks and participants. Increasing the addressable market for structured trade finance solutions to tier two, tier three suppliers for banks. And a new time stamp and real time record of what participant choices have been made by the.
Yeah, so please, everybody mute because we cannot hear Tom speaking. Go ahead, Tom, please.
So thanks, guys. So yeah, so look, just an overview in terms of the benefits of why use Daml for structured trade finance. But I hope that everybody found that. That demo and the webinar useful so far. I think we're just coming up on time here, Andrea. So what I think probably makes sense is to maybe open up the floor to some of the questions.
Absolutely. There are a few questions in the pipeline, guys. The first one comes from Shane DeConing, and he's asking, I'm interested in security. Is there a translation to a lower level smart contract language to audit the raw code that's generated?
So I think you're on mute there, Ian.
Can you hear me, Tom?
I can, yeah. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can.
Sorry,
hear
guys,
you.
Just coming off mute. Yeah, I'll try to take that for you, Shane. I think what your question is, so is this kind of, I guess what you're saying is, are we translating the Daml language into the smart contract language of the ledger that we're operating on? And the answer to that is no, that's not quite the way it works. So we pass the transactions that get defined within in Daml as an opaque blob really to the lower level ledger. So whilst we use the ledger to provide distribution sequencing, finalization, and notary type services, we're not translating all of the code into the lower level ledger language. Okay, so the business logic is all sitting in the Daml layer, and that's where the logic and the permissions are applied.
Thanks, Ian.
Does that help?
Yeah, that makes sense. It's a shame. Perfect. Ian and Tom, there's a question from my friend Frank. Is asking involves KYC processes. Are the e-signatures based on law? It's a good question, especially under the, let's say, the perspective of the MLETR and say the evolving legal infrastructure.
So I'm guessing the question really is, would these, the where we have somebody signing a contract, would it be legally enforceable? Is that really the question?
Yeah. Are the e-signature based on law? Yeah. How do you structure the e-signatures? Are they based on law or only technical stuff?
So I think, Tom, you may want to come in on this as well, but my understanding of how this is, what would work is that the participants would have a legal agreement that committed them to honouring what was agreed on this system. So it's not like if I give you a piece of paper and I say, sign this, then you're committed at that point because you have physically signed and that is recognized in law. These signatures are not quite the same as that. So I think if you wanted to have that level of enforcement, you would have to have a separate agreement with the parties whereby they agreed that this would be enforceable. But by default, I don't believe it would be.
Perfect. And the second part of the question, actually, do you integrate into ERP systems for where orders are generated?
We certainly can do that. So one of the things that Daml does very nicely is it generates some very easy to use APIs. There's two APIs available, in fact. So there's a ledger API, which is quite low level, and there's a higher level, easier to use JSON API as well. So yes, we have lots of customers who integrate with lots of different line of business systems. It's relatively straightforward to do using that API. So you certainly could integrate with existing ERP systems.
Nice, thank you, Ian. There's a question from Mr. Guy Hofstetteler. He's asking, had you considered using Daml as a build-time only layer that then translates to the underlying platform runtime pool that better leverages that platform features? He's asking, would that not create a better separation of concerns?
It's a very good question.
That's a very technical one, actually.
I'm not the deepest techie here with the greatest depth of knowledge of Daml, but my understanding is obviously that has been considered at some point in the lifetime of Daml as it's evolved. And I think the reality is that just doing that is too complicated. And in a way, it makes it harder to separate the concerns because if you imagine the number of ledgers that we'd have to support and trying to match our abstract Daml language and being able to translate the abstract Daml language into the ledger specific implementations of every supported ledger would be exceedingly hard to do. So I think in a way, the architecture that we've got is better, where you're abstracting that away and you're saying we'll manage the business logic within the Daml runtime, and we'll use the ledger more as that infrastructure layer, as I say, providing the distribution, the sequencing, the finalization, the notarization type services, but not have it. We're not trying to leverage the different smart contract languages that some of those support, because they're all different with different capabilities and different features. You'd end up with Daml being constrained to only support the kind of the lowest common denominator, if you like, of those languages between them. Whereas with the architecture we've got a lot more freedom to be able to implement the functionality that we want. So yes, I'm sure it's been considered, but I don't think it would be a good architecture choice for us to go to.
Thanks, Ian. There's another question, unknown actually, because I cannot see who made the question. How easy is the onboarding process for someone who is part of the supply chain contract Daml? How we are assured data is secured in the contract chain? And is there a limit to participants that can be part of, say, supply chain contract? Oh, I cannot read through. Sorry.
Who wants to onboard the Daml?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Who want to onboard Daml? Nikita. That's Nikita, actually. The name was at the end.
Yeah, that's fine. Tom, do you want me to take that one as well?
Go ahead, yeah.
Cool. So there's several questions there. So let's unpack that. How easy is the onboarding process for somebody who's part of the supply chain? So, I mean, what we've shown you here is a demo. What Daml does is it implements your business logic for you. So you need to decide what you want your onboarding process to be. And I think really kind of like how easy or hard that onboarding process is down to a large extent to you to define, because that's really comes down to business requirements. Once you've decided what that is, then it is relatively easy to implement that logic in Daml, because that's what Daml does really well. It's really good at implementing business logic. Okay. Is that okay, Nikita, to answer your question?
Thank you. Yes, that helps.
I'll move on to the next bit though. How are we assured that data is secured in the contract chain? So what we are doing here is Daml is providing that runtime where the business logic is and where the functionality that I've been showing you today and the language that I've shown you today runs. In terms of how the data is secured in the underlying chain, that's really a feature of the chain that you choose to build this on. So nothing really fundamentally changes there. If you were to base this on top of Hyperledger, then you would benefit from the security that's in the Hyperledger chain. Okay, so that really comes down to choosing an infrastructure provider and a DLT that meets your security requirements.
Perfect, Ian.
Okay. And then
question from G plus R.
Sorry, Andre, there was one more part to Peter's question, actually. Is there a limit to the number of participants that can be part of a supply chain contract? The answer is no, not really. I mean, this would scale. You know, we've got people like stock exchanges using Daml, hundreds of thousands or millions of transactions going through. So no, you could make this arbitrarily complex. No worries, you're very welcome, Nikita.
Yeah. There is the question that I was referring to, Ian. Can you speak to performance of the blockchain systems with application built with Daml? Any heuristics in terms of TPS will be helpful.
Yes. So funnily enough, I've been looking at this the very thing this week. As I said, we've got major enterprise clients using this. So the likes of banks and stock exchanges, putting through considerable volumes of transactions. I know that we have, certainly I know we have up in terms of TPS, I have seen certainly above 10,000 transactions per second in one example. Now that was sufficient for the client's requirements. I'm sure you could architect a solution to go considerably higher than that if you needed to do so.
Okay.
You're very welcome, Jerry.
I think there is another question from Shane.
Yes. Would it be possible to perform some kind of revocation or overriding on cases like non-fulfillment or change of contractual parties? Yeah, absolutely, Shane. Great question, actually. The way you would do that is that's just business logic, right? So if you wanted to define that within your business logic, so maybe have a revocation choice on your fulfillment request or on your order or something like that, then absolutely you would just build that into your Daml, because that's just business logic. You just write it into the code. And we do, with some other examples and some other customers we work with, very much have that kind of thing.
Good, Ian, perfect. I would love to take questions, I mean, to give you answers. And I would love to have your opinion, Ian, how one can get started with Daml. What blockchains can Daml run on, and how you service DLT or blockchain to run Daml on? Can you give us a few hints, you know, just the peak start points.
Sure. Tom, do you want to take the start of that one?
Yeah, so... So thanks for all those answers here. Very helpful. So to get started with Daml, Daml is open source. You can go on daml.com, download our SDK for free, and start creating your applications with Daml. Typically that's the best way to get started. There is a very vibrant and diverse developer community as well. That you can access through discuss.daml. I think it's discuss.daml.com.
Yeah, or on the from the daml.com website, just go to community.
Exactly, and so that's, you know, for people interested in starting to use Daml, that would be a great first step.
Yeah, and people are very welcome to post questions onto that community as well. It's very active and it's a great place actually to get help. If you just want to download the SDK and you're struggling with anything, then feel free to use that community.
Yeah, just another thing, guys. I was wondering, how about the data? Who owns the data? And the network, of course.
Great question. Do you want me to take that one?
Go for it. Yeah.
So that's really up to you. So we have different models that you can operate. So you can operate this in a fairly centralized way if you want, where you can, I mean, you can actually take this if you want to and just deploy it all within your own environment, your own network, and it's purely yours. You can open that out to allow external parties to come in and access. You can host nodes on behalf of external parties, or you can create a completely decentralized network with external parties where each party owns one or more nodes, or several parties may choose to own a node together. But there is no overall owner of the network if you want to do that. So that's really, really up to you. Again, that's largely determined by the underlying infrastructure that you choose to build this on. Okay. So I think there was one more question actually, Tom, which was what ledgers does this run on? So what are our supported ledgers? You had that in the slide, actually, I think.
I did, yeah. Let me go back.
Oh, okay. Well, that's pretty cool.
It's probably worth checking daml.com as well, because it's always it's always changing. There's always new ones being added, right?
Yeah, so... Okay, so if you can see my screen there, that's just a cross-section of some of the enterprise blockchains, distributed ledgers, and centralized databases that we that can connect to. The list is changing all the time. So, you know, as Ian says, keep an eye on daml.com to make sure that you keep abreast of that. But, you know, most of the leading distributed ledgers we can connect to.
Yeah. In fact, if you Google Daml supported ledgers, it's the first result that comes up. So,
I would love to listen to the attendants once again to see whether they have any more questions, any further questions for you, Ian, and Tom. Anybody else would love to bring questions?
I think we're looking pretty good. So,
one, I guess,
from Shane.
Yeah, any plans to integrate with the public blockchain in the future? It's a good one.
Very good question.
Indeed.
We thought someone would ask that. Tom, do you want to answer that? Do you want me to take that?
You go for it. Yeah.
Sure. So, it's a great question, Shane. It's a question that, I'm sure you'd expect to be asked a lot. We have a community edition of Ethereum Driver at the moment, so that integration is there. We are also actually working on a different connector as well, which is which will enable us to kind of bridge between our networks and public networks as well. So, yes, there are some developments going on there. But it's very much driven by client need as well. I don't know if you want to add any more on that one, Tom.
No, I think you got it covered there, Ian. Thanks.
It's just saying thanks.
Great stuff, Shane. You're very welcome.
Yeah. Ian, I don't know if you can answer this one. How do you manage changes to smart contract model once you're live?
Ah, great question. It's actually...
I love putting you in difficulties, Ian.
No, I like that. This is a question we also get asked quite a lot, actually. In fact, it's a question that I asked when I started at Digital Asset as well. If you think about it, a change to your set of smart contracts is really business logic. So it's actually easy to do because you create a template for a smart contract, which is an upgrade contract. And it can take it can take your old contracts and create upgraded versions of them. So it's really slick the way it happens. You basically create upgraded templates and you apply that to the chain to the ledger, and you allow them to, or you can choose the manner by which they will upgrade your existing smart contracts. So you use the tooling itself to kind of like almost upgrade itself, if that makes sense. But it's relatively easy to do, and it's quite a powerful technique. So you use you have kind of upgrade smart contracts. So you can imagine you even have different versions of, maybe I've got invite supplier V1 and invite supplier V2, and you can pass the V1 into V2 and it will create a V2, that kind of thing.
Thank you, Ian.
Right,
sure. Anybody else would love to make questions? Let me see whether in the chat. No further questions. I think we're exceeding time. And
yeah,
I think, Eric, would you like to make questions to the speakers?
Feel free. Ooh, I have one more question. David has asked, has a contract ever failed? Yeah, of course, contracts can fail. One of the things I didn't say with Daml that perhaps is worth mentioning, though, is that, yeah, things can go wrong. Of course, business logic can fail. There could be, something could fail in the infrastructure layer. But one of the nice things about Daml is all of the business logic that I encapsulate within a choice is guaranteed to be atomic. So it will either everything will pass or everything will fail. So, same as you get with the atomic transactions in the database, it's atomic. So, yeah, if you get a failure, then you'll get an entire failure of a transaction. So yes, things can go wrong, but the system handles that very robustly. Can we select the deployment underlying? Sorry, guys, it's going on. Jay says, can we select the deployment underlying framework? Should we make this the last question? Because we are out of time. If anyone does have any more questions, I'm sure if they send them through to Andrea, he'll be very happy to forward them on to us. Would that be okay, Andrea?
No, it is okay. Go on. Ian, just answer this last question, then I think we should close the session.
No worries at all. Can we select deployment underlying framework as different participants in the network? that's something that we are... we're kind of working on at the moment. If you visit canton.io, that's some technology that we're working on, which basically would allow interconnections between different networks. So right now, if you go to daml.com and download our SDK, then the code you would build there, you would run on one ledger, but we are working on the ability to interconnect different networks as well. Yes, Jay, that is going to be something that's just about there now, and it's something we'll be developing further in the next year. So yes, you're very welcome, Jay. Okay.
So thank you so much, guys, for this presentation.
Drio, we can't hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Can you hear me, Ian?
Yes.
Perfect. I was bidding goodbye to everybody, and I was thanking you and Tom for this insightful presentation. It was great to have you both here and hope to see you again. We're going to join forces in 1 week. Stay all well and keep in contact. Have a great evening, guys.
Thank you very much, Andre, and thank you for the opportunity.
Bye, Ian. Have a great evening.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye, Tom.